Emily Bell, stage is yours.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Justin. I know I am the person standing between you and the bar, and I'm a British journalist, so I know that's a really perilous position to be in. So I will keep it. I will keep it short, and as Justin said, I will keep it topical. Thanks very much, Media Lab, for having me here. It's great to be here, even though I usually only have to walk across the quad. The other thing you should know about me today is that I've risen from my sick bed, because I'm a slight hypochondriac, so I'm assuming I have walking pneumonia. I think it's just a slight cold. But if I fall over at any point and have to be removed, I don't want you to think that that makes me unfit to be president, because I absolutely am, apart from the bursa issue. Thank you. Thank you very much. The Media Lab is a really important institution to us here at Columbia, because it sits in that space between the industry, between education, and kind of fills that sort of interdisciplinary space, which we at the Journalism School have been training kind of an amazing sort of set of new students to move into. And when I was preparing this talk, because I hated it when Justin said, I asked you a year ago. So I was thinking, because he asked me a year ago, you would think I would have finished this more than 3 hours ago. But he did say, keep it topical. And I was thinking about that interdisciplinary space, which is really where we work at the Tau Center. So when I came here 6 years ago, I came from the background of being a practitioner. And I thought, this is going to be really easy. Everybody knows that kind of journalists are just not digitally savvy enough. They just don't get it. I worked in a newsroom where we had some of the best technologists and the best journalists in the world at The Guardian, and we did amazing things. And I thought, well, if we can just kind of make the whole field more like that, it will be job done, problem solved. But actually, kind of, it didn't quite work out like that, which is sort of good in a way, because it means that I'm not out of a job yet. It's not that there weren't easy fixes for journalism. You know, we have a school now which is 20% of our graduate students are now either data or computational journalism concentrators, which is amazing because there were none of them sort of 5 years ago. It's not that we haven't fixed some of the simple things, and it's amazing to see journalism remaking itself. It's just that the problems have got bigger and more complicated. And while I was backstage, it was really interesting listening to some of your questions about what the limits of amazing technologies are. So now that I'm not quite a practitioner, I still have one foot in the journalism camp, but I see things slightly differently. I see them as what is it we can do in universities, and what is it we can do with the industry to work on things which are really big problems, the really hard problems. I think there are quite a few, and I just wanted to pick one today to talk about, which reflects, I hope, the topicality in the news. And that really hard problem is, how do we make a better environment for news, journalism, and commentary at a time when everybody now, quite rightly, has democratic access to an amazing array of publishing tools? For the next 2 years, our major area of research at the Tau Center is going to be in that relation, the gap, not gap, because there is none anymore, the relationship between platforms and publishers, which I believe is the biggest change we've seen really in kind of the operation of the free press, probably for about 400 years. I'm happy to have people disagree with me on that, but I think that what's happening now in that shift of publishing responsibility and tools to the major platforms is the biggest thing that we've really seen happen to the independent press for, well, since the invention of the printing press. So I just want to say some sort of, there's some good news. So the really good news, and for people who heard the last panel, that's really good news. Incidentally, about 3 months ago, I came into work and the lobby of the journalism school was like crowded with these like 12, 13, 14-year-olds. And I was like, this is amazing. All of these great sort of middle school, high school kids coming in here, you know, really dedicated to the idea of coming in and learning journalism. I thought we'll have to get them off that kind of habit of looking at their phones And then I said to someone, isn't this great? This must be a tour. And they said, no, the J School is a poker stop. So we had... Sorry, slight diversion. So the good news is you have these amazing technologies, right? So in the last 5 or 6 years, we have seen journalism really benefit from... So in news gathering, if you think about what technologies we can do now, we can test and monitor our environment. Water quality in Flint can be tested by sensors. We can use satellite imaging to track land loss and climate change and migration patterns. We can use network data skills to take huge caches of documents and mine out international fraud and other wrongdoing. You know, we can reverse engineer algorithms. This is something ProPublica did in the story. It's something that we wrote papers about 2 years ago, and now it's happening in the newsroom, which is we can investigate algorithms to highlight financial services, policing, unfairness in their, how math is discriminatory. And we can use crowdsourcing and social media presence to really refine our journalism and engage in dialogue. And we can use virtual and augmented reality to really make amazing stories and put people in the story, not just present it to them. And they're incredible tools that my students can use now. So, you could data miner or Banjo can tell you when news is breaking before the emergency services. We have, as Mark Zuckerberg himself said, and I'll be returning to him in a minute, we all now, thanks to Facebook Live, have the power of a television studio in our pockets. So why, when we have all these dazzling new technologies and amazing ways to tell stories, these new tools of precision and accuracy, why are we at a point where it feels as though we are in crisis in the news media? So I don't know how many people saw the NBC Wall Street Journal poll yesterday, but on a long list of things that Americans felt positively about, of which Canada was right at the top, I'm not kidding, so Canada was the thing about which Americans feel most positively, and the news media was right at the bottom. Actually, the news media was not right at the bottom. There was one item below us, and that was Vladimir Putin. So the idea that we have these amazing technologies, and yet somehow we are at a point where we're considered to be in crisis. And we have some evidence for being in crisis, right? So, I can't vote. I'm not sort of going to declare my political allegiances. I try and be as neutral as I possibly can be. But you have to say that the rise of a candidate such as Donald Trump, who is, I don't think that, your libel laws are not that sort of enforced here, are they? So he's a sort of charismatic, racist, serial liar. He's a shady business, well, he is, sorry. He's a shady businessman. And he's now a potential presidential candidate. And this has caused widespread questioning of not just the role of journalism in creating him or the role of media in creating him, but also in failing to stop him or failing to point out to people that a candidate that even a large number of his own party won't endorse is not actually kind of fit to be president, or at least we should be questioning him more closely. So journalism during this political cycle, I think, has been shown as its absolute worst and at its absolute best. David Farenthold of the Washington Post. Yes, clap. We should all be applauding David Farenthold. And if you're not and you don't know what he's doing, go and look at his Twitter feed right now. So the Washington Post, he's doggedly, daily documenting Trump's use of charitable funds to settle his own business problems. And it's revelatory stuff, but it's also using the amazing power of Twitter. He's crowdsourced stories, he's asked about gaps in funding, he's relentlessly pursued the case against Trump's use of these finances. But then at the worst, well, you know, kind of, I don't really know where to start with the worst, but you could pick a cable network and go and watch it. And, you know, the idea that you are in a world where people are not challenged on false assertions, where people will lie, and this is candidates of either party, where journalists are too scared to interrupt or to be seen to be biased by really holding power to account, has made the normally pretty navel-gazing fields of journalism almost kind of implode with anxiety about what we're doing, and quite rightly too, because, you know, it is our job supposedly to mine out truth and present it to a broad public. The problem of false equivalent untruths, rumor, aggressive discourse actually goes a long way beyond what happens in our on our TV screens. So in 2016, we've seen really the fusing of the relationship between journalism and social media. Facebook instant articles, Twitter moments, Snapchat Discover, Google AMP pages, and, you know, all of these are sort of tools which are encouraging us to move our journalism off our platform and onto social platforms. And I think the fact that this is happening at a time where there is this crisis in confidence in the news media, and where people don't feel that they trust information sources, I'm not saying that the one has inevitably led to the other, but I do think that the two are related. So first of all, almost half the country now gets some of its news or sees as a primary source of news Facebook, its Facebook feed. The mainstream media and social networks are actually no longer separate entities, they're the same thing. And at a time of political upheaval and change, both the reporting of campaigns and facts and the discussion of them is critical. So this is not just about the reporting of facts, this is also about how we disseminate and how we discuss them. I know that Mark Zuckerberg does not think that Facebook is a media company. In fact, he said so explicitly again in Italy 2 weeks ago. He doesn't think that it has the responsibility of editing and shaping what the world sees. But unfortunately for him, I have some sympathy with Mark Zuckerberg in this, I would not want to be editing the world's output either. But unfortunately for him, this is exactly the role that Facebook and he, and in fairness, other platforms as well. This is not just Facebook. We talk about Facebook a lot because it is by far and away the largest. This is the role that they're cast in. I don't know how many of you followed the saga last month of the, actually this month, of the photograph of Nick Utt, the very famous iconic image from Vietnam of the girl running down the road, her clothes burnt off by napalm, and the fact that it was removed from the page of a Norwegian journalist by Facebook's algorithm because it looked as though it breached their terms of use about naked children. You can't have pictures of naked children on your Facebook pages. This is a picture of a naked child. And the Norwegian press and, in fact, the Norwegian Prime Minister all pushed back on Facebook and said, surely you can recognize that there is a qualitative difference between an iconic and important image and the kinds of images that you are trying to stop. Initially, Facebook said, no, we don't see the difference. And then after a lot of publicity, they relented and said, okay, we've considered this, we think it's different. Espen Egil Hansen, who's the editor-in-chief of Aftenposten, which is the place where the original article and image came from, wrote an open letter to Mark Zuckerberg, which was great. It's very Norwegian. He started, "Dear Mark," which is very disarming, and then went on to sort of really sort of criticize the idea that Facebook wouldn't take seriously its role of editing the world. Hansen hasn't sort of, if you like, the image has been restored, but Hansen doesn't think the issue has gone away, and I think we don't think the issue has gone away either. In fact, on Tuesday, he wrote an editorial opinion in The Guardian where he criticized how Facebook, first of all, makes editorial decisions, and secondly, how it, if you like, denies it is making editorial decisions. And he said, algorithms that primarily make sure users are being fed more of what they like and less of what they don't like are convenient when you're watching Netflix, but are a questionable principle for the free flow of information to democracy. So we know in the past that when Facebook was criticized this way, it has implemented collaborative filtering. So humans, this is basically putting humans in the machine. And the company subsequently was criticized for downweighting what we call far-right websites. And as a result of that, Facebook thought that it was easier just to get rid of its curation team and said it's now all done by algorithm. The result of getting rid of its curation team and doing everything by algorithm has been that there's been a rise of false, completely false stories proliferating because machines find it very, very hard to tell the difference between a true story and a false story. Craig Silverman, who was one of our Tau fellows and is now editor of BuzzFeed Canada, carried out research for us on the proliferation of fake news a couple of years ago, and his study showed that for everyone sharing fake news on Facebook, many, many fewer shared the debunking of the fake news. So what his study proved was that more speech, we have this idea that that better speech will drown out bad speech or false speech. And his study showed that that is actually not necessarily the case, that sometimes in public discourse, that problem doesn't fix itself. Just recently, Craig revisited this issue and wrote a really excellent article about it, which I'd urge you all to read. And he said that Facebook has failed, completely failed, in its efforts to suppress fake news, largely because it won't admit that it needs human editors, that its position on not being an editorial company is so entrenched and so important to it that actually we as a result are seeing enormous numbers of pages and articles proliferate which are not necessarily verifiable. And John Herman, you might think, well, you know, does it really matter? So John Herman wrote a really great piece in the New York Times Magazine at the beginning of September saying that where he unearthed this amazing world of highly partisan websites which are often cynically put together. There's a young man who said he makes a doctor's salary from aggregating the worst, if you like, of the sort of the far-right memes and putting them on pages and sending them to hundreds of thousands of followers. And he makes quite a bit of money out of it. And as John Herman noted in his piece, the engagement, the shares, the likes on these pages are incredibly high. It is not that people are ignoring them and saying, you know, this is not something that we should be reading. The fact that the existence of these pages, the fact that we know that something is broken in discourse, is really problematic for Facebook, and it's quite problematic for journalism. Just as we haven't quite worked out how we should react and report in a networked world, they're having exactly the same problems with pages and articles which are not absolutely illegal, but also are not which make us uncomfortable and which mislead people about what is really going on out there. We protect free speech because it's very important and it's powerful and it has consequences, but balancing those freedoms is really difficult. And it can't be done without thought, context, transparency, and debate. And most challengingly, I think, for social media, the principle of designing for the individual user doesn't often solve for the problem of designing for a better collective experience or for an outcome in society, which is not simply about getting a consumer to consume more of what they like. This weekend, actually, I took some of our papers. We have a new set of papers out from the Tau Center, which look at terrorism, the election cycle, and Islamophobia in America. And it's incredibly sobering to share a platform with young American Muslims who feel that it's difficult or impossible for them to engage in debate on social media because the threat and the hate and the unpleasantness is such that it chills their own public expression. And these are often journalists who feel, you know, pretty okay about this sort of thing. So if that's the effect it's having on them, then imagine the effect it's having on everybody else who really should be participating in that debate. So we know that Twitter and Facebook and Google are all wrestling somewhat unsuccessfully with this idea of censorship, at least in the commercial sphere. We also know that if you want to watch a piece of geographically restricted content, like a football match that you're not supposed to watch in the US, they're very good at pinpointing things that you shouldn't see and making sure that you don't see it. But if there is something which is hateful, provocative, alarmist, wrong, then it apparently is much, much harder to take that kind of material off the network. And before we kind of pile on to the social media platforms, where I think part of this problem is now rooted, I would say that the news media has been absolutely no better, and often worse in how it monitors or encourages online discourse. Increasingly, we've seen news organizations cede control of comments or communities to big platform companies. So many news organizations switch off comments now and say, let Facebook deal with it. And our own coverage is also often colored, I think, by wanting to maximize clicks and audience and reach and shares. And complicated stories are much harder to get people to share and read than simple stories. And Trump's outrageous comments, anyone's outrageous comments, are much better copy than the nitty-gritty of the paperwork. So we can't really start tackling this issue, which is staring us in the face, until we all see it as our problem, I think. And I do think that it is our problem. I think it is a problem of universities and J schools, of technologists who work in this area, journalists, politicians, people who work in social media companies, and even, dare I say, investors to solve. Now, I know that's a rather sort of downbeat message on which to end the day, but Justin did ask me to come up with something topical, which would, if you like, sort of throw a challenge out there. We're always talking about moonshots in terms of technology and what can be achieved. Well, getting the right facts and the right debate out to the public and encouraging a well-informed society is really a very difficult moonshot. But I think that we should all be trying to do it together, because there just isn't a better cause on which to collaborate. So with that, thank you very much indeed. I'll be happy to take questions.
Time for a Q&A? Okay.
So I'm going to...
That was very downbeat.
It's fun. There's cocktails beer and wine, at least, to make us feel a little bit better. I'm going to ask immediately to the audience for some questions. I don't want to run too much over time. So if anyone wants to immediately jump up and fire a question at Emily Bell, you're welcome to it.
So you were just talking about removing fake articles and how we kind of tell the difference, right? I've seen recently a lot of major media organizations kind of fall suit with Onion and jump on the satire bandwagon.
Right.
Obviously very consumable, a lot of fun,
yep.
But a lot of people can't tell the difference. And where does that algorithm fit in?
Mm-hmm. So computers don't understand humor, huh?
Yeah, I mean, it's really interesting. I noticed that the Times of India has a website where they actually have a section now, they did have a section called fake news. And they would brand articles fake news. And there is a problem, right, which is, as you say, as reality has converged with the Onion world of satire, knowing what's true and not true is increasingly difficult. But on a serious point, that sort of filtering for tone, again, is something which is actually really hard to do. It's much easier for humans to do it than it is for machines to do it. So I guess, in a way, what I'm saying is you kind of need you need an editorial response, and you need it in terms of how you design the technology, and you need to acknowledge it, because your values when you're creating one set of technology might not be somebody else's values. So metadata on an article can provide some of the answers, but often once it's stripped of metadata and out there on something like Facebook or whatever, then it's kind of gone. And satire is less of a problem than things which sound real but are not funny and are, you know, spread pretty widely. And I was a great optimist. Like, when I was at The Guardian, I was a great optimist. I really thought that kind of we would balance this thing out by community policing, etc. But the scale of it now and actually the kind of impact of it, I think, means that, you know, it needs to be taken much more seriously. Well, I think it's taken seriously. We're just not doing anything
about it. Well, and the fact that so much of the argument online right now is even between humans. It's between between bots and other bad agents. Yes, ma'am.
So first, thank you. This has been really an amazing day. I'm curious about sort of digital divide, because a lot of what I've been hearing today has been really exciting and strains of utopia, you know, notwithstanding your down note at the end. And I'm not even sure what my question is exactly, other than I feel like the increase in technological platforms, do you think that just increases the possibility of widening the digital divide? Or is the feeling that somehow there'll be these additional platforms that can help bridge that digital divide? I you know, it just feels also very timely in this election cycle, because the divide, I think, is a really big problem.
I think it's a great question, and that issue of kind of inequality. I mean, I come from Britain, and we had a very similar kind of shock vote to leave the European Union. And lots of people, like you couldn't find an academic economist who would think it was a good idea. You had people sort of voting for it who would really be probably some of the people who would be most disadvantaged. And a lot of the campaigning was on the back of fear. And particularly sort of, you know, very hyped up talk about immigration. And it doesn't mean those issues aren't real and they shouldn't be addressed, but it just meant that we, again, Britain had it, went through exactly the same cycle that America is going through at the moment. And so the news media, I think, you know, part of the problem is how you cover that divide in the first place. And actually technology is a real problem. I think civic tech has long had this at the heart of how it thinks about developing products. I think that Silicon Valley, which is that combination of very sort of pure engineering thinking and Wall Street growth targets, has been much less good. Whatever its intent when it sets out, you know, kind of it's almost like a machine for inequality. But I think we have to start to think how we even that up. And I don't think the answer is to say all technology is bad. I think it should be an enabler for closing that. But I think civic tech has a much diminished voice these days against, you know, platform technologies and really big tech. But they have to be part of the solution, because they have the resources. At the end of the day, they have the resources.
Yes, sir.
Hey, I was wondering if you think that there's a problem with, like, on Facebook, and I agree that I get a lot of my news from Facebook. Do you think there's a problem with self-curation? Because if you look at my Facebook feed, no one in the world is voting for Donald Trump, because hidden people or defriended them or
filter
whatever.
Bubble.
What's that?
The filter bubble.
Yeah. So, I mean, I'm getting news that I've filtered to me. You know what I mean? So is there a way, I mean, I don't know. What do you think about that issue?
I think this is something, again, which has really kind of ambushed both Facebook and sort of the rest of us. In that Eli Pariser wrote his great book about the filter bubble, I don't know what, kind of over, sort of nearly 10 years ago, like a long time ago, and spotted this. And again, I think just that sort of the way that the algorithm works to give you more of what you like and engage with means that there is no intervention or interruption that says you'll necessarily see anything else which you need to see. And this comes down to the sort of fact of, are there circumstances under which a big platform, doesn't have to be Facebook, but any big platform, would interrupt its algorithm and say, we think this is important. Now, the interesting thing about Facebook is it's absolutely fine putting a label that says news at the top of its page. News is a value judgment. That's an editorial word. And by saying news, you mean this is recent and it's important, you should pay attention to it. And I don't think it's an excuse to say everything underneath it is therefore kind of curated by you. It doesn't make, you know, it sort of doesn't make sense. But Facebook has no history of this. You know, they are building an amazing company which does incredible things very, very, very quickly. And they have 1.6 billion active users. And they have a kajillion problems every day. But they've stepped very much into this role of, we are going to produce the tools that allow you to see live video. We're going to make it really easy for your news pages to load very, very quickly. We're going to, you know, dominate the advertising market. You cannot then say the thing which has real democratic importance, oh, we're just going to leave that to you. That's not, I don't think that that's a sustainable or an acceptable position.
Got a last question from the audience.
Hi. I'm Canadian, so I can appreciate Americans wanting to, you know.
It's mostly Justin Trudeau.
It is mostly. It is. I get that. You know, I appreciate that. I want to move the conversation a little bit beyond Facebook and Twitter, yep, and a little bit into VR and AR, where we were talking earlier about today.
Yeah.
How do you feel that ethics is going to play in that type of environment when you can create content,
right,
that is void of images, like the young girl from the napalm picture, which is sort of that extension of that discussion that I read, yep, about taking that out? And if you, yep, do that, now you're changing content at a whole different level, yep, that isn't in the public realm like the Facebook and the Twitter.
So do these problems compound with, right, the advance of digital media?
Well, I think that what compounds it is that sense that this is real. So, yeah, we talk about virtual reality, or we talk about augmented reality. And I think it's, you know, we have done quite a lot of work on VR at the J School. We've partnered with PBS Frontline. We made two separate kind of documentary segments, one around Ebola, one around famine in southern Sudan, and those are not great kind of like, hey, let's ski down a mountain. But it would be wrong of me to say that there aren't journalistic kind of challenges in that, which is you're absolutely right, whose reality is this that you're playing into? How can you trust that? The empathy and the manipulation of people's emotions are something which is very different to kind of, you know, I come from a generation where playing music over a news segment was considered to be like a really terrible thing to do, because you're making people think something about the news. We really do have to rethink lots and lots and lots of our different sort of, you know, approaches to objectivity or balance or seeking the truth. We should always be seeking, you know, the truth, or as close as we can get to it within these new frameworks of technology. And I think VR and AR present us with amazing journalistic opportunities, but you have to really acknowledge that there is a very significant challenge around, you know, empathy in news, around ethics in news, about how it's presented. And this is a conversation that everyone should have. One of the things we want to do at the Town Centre is get as many stakeholders involved in these conversations, because it's amazing what other fields can actually bring to these discussions, you know, where ethicists have been thinking about these kinds of things for a long time. But I don't think it's straightforwardly, I don't think any of these things are straightforwardly either good or bad. Mm-hmm. I do think that we're not examining them perhaps as much as we could on the way.
I'll ask the last question, moderator's prerogative, and maybe it's a foolish one, but knowing that we've got this extraordinary transition that we're going through, the economics of sort of traditional news media journalism under threat, rise of the platforms, filter up, all the things that we've just talked about, are you optimistic that that democracy will sort of survive this transition and that we'll figure it out?
I'm fundamentally always optimistic, even though you might not think that. But I'm also, you know, aware that you can very quickly slip from a position of having made progress. And, you know, kind of you look at historical cycles, you can see that sort of, you know, I think we've come to the point where we think, well, terrible things don't happen in the world anymore. We maybe reached that point at about 2000, and by 2003, we had...
End of history.
We had, yeah, the end of history, exactly. You know, hey, it's all going to be great. And then 3 years later, we're in, you know, a really kind of like critical global situation. And we have complicated stories like climate change, which are not necessarily, you know, which are political in themselves. So I think that sort of, you know, democracy is a great thing. And, you know, you have to have optimism that the human race is incredibly sort of robust and quite smart. But I don't think it's wrong. And I think often, particularly sort of the techno-positivists, think it's wrong to even question whether or not we should have regulation or whether or not we should really sort of think about some of like how you protect people. I don't think the market economy fixes for that, but you know, like the Canadian, I'm from Europe, so I would never think that anyway.
When I was at The Economist, they like to refer to themselves as paranoid optimists.
Yes, paranoid.
Thank you very much, Emily.
Thank you, Justin.